is more regulatory in nature. So the quick opening valve opens in almost no time, let's say in less than 1 second, or I mean, depending on the size. So it can even open in 0.2 seconds or 0.3 seconds, depending on the size. It quickly opens, it opens faster than the anti-surge valve to quickly recycle gas and maintain forward flow. But let's say, despite putting putting a quick opening valve and you're still not able to recycle enough flow, then what you can do is you can go to the next method, which is you try to reduce the amount of gas inventory, the amount of gas that is sitting on the discharge side. Because if you have more gas on the discharge side, it takes longer for it to be recycled back. So what we call response time. So if you have just a small quantity, quickly you can try. If you just have a small quantity here of gas, you can quickly transfer it back to the suction side. But let's say you have a massive amount of volume here on, then it takes a longer time for the gas to go back to the suction. And by the time it reaches, some of the gas will flow back into the, by the time this gas reaches the suction side, some of it will already go back and cause a surge, which we don't want it to happen. So what happens is often, despite increasing the anti-surge valve size, it does not necessarily solve the problems, simply because you have a very high amount of gas inventory, large volume. The cooler is large, the pipe sizes are pretty big. So there's a many meter cubes of gas is sitting there, and it takes a lot of effort to take it back to the suction. So if that is the case, try to see if you can reduce the distance, the piping distance. However, there is a limit to how much you can reduce it. Because if you move the cooler close to the compressor suction and also the tap off point closer to the suction, then you can have vibration issues. So the cooler, the louvers on the cooler can keep vibrating, the cooler frame itself can vibrate, the pipes can vibrate, and when the pipes vibrate, the vibration is transmitted to the anti-surge valve. So the anti-surge valve will also start to experience vibrations. So we do not want to push it too close to the compressor discharge. Now, let's say this also failed. This is not giving you answers. Then what you do is, during a shutdown, during an emergency shutdown, try to slow down the speed. During a normal shutdown, during a planned event, what you do is, if the anti-surge valve is insufficient, then what you do is you slow down the speed at which the compressor is coasting down. So if it takes 1 minute to go to zero speed from 3000 RPM to zero RPM, then what you do is you don't shut it down in 1 minute. You shut it down in 3-4 minutes. You do it much slower. So that way the anti-surge valve has sufficient time to quickly recycle as much as it can. However, there is a limitation with this method. This method is only applicable for normal shutdown with variable speed drives. Because with the variable speed drive, you can alter the speed, at what speed you want the speed to go to zero. But in the case of a fixed speed drive, let's say there was a power failure, there is no way you can control. It's like, you know, you're at home, you have your mixie, and the moment you switch off the mixie, what happens? There is no way you can control the speed at which it comes. It will come to rest, but you can't decide how many seconds it should take to come to zero. So it slowly rotates and it goes to zero speed. So this method is only for normal shutdown with variable frequency drive. Did I lose control, sir? I mean, draw. Yeah. Okay.
You have the control.
Oh, you're using it, is it? Okay. Yeah.
You have the control.
Okay. So I put some notes here, which you can refer to. There are some notes here to understand more, because this material is for you and you can understand this thing. So the next method is rerouting the piping itself. Maybe if it is a greenfield job, what we can do is we can reroute the pipes in such a way to reduce the amount of volume, to reduce the amount of pressure drop. In a greenfield project, it is possible at the front end stage itself, if you can figure it out, then in the detailing phase, it shouldn't cause hassles. But let's say it's a brownfield job And by you reroute the pipe in such a way which you think is good for you, but because of the existing facilities, if the routing does not fit in properly there, then it's a problem. The piping guys can also get pretty upset. So you can reroute the pipe depending on the situation, whether greenfield or brown greenfield. It's the best because the plant is not built and you can reroute the pipe to ensure that you are able to quickly transfer the gas back to the suction. In a brownfield job, if there is sufficient space, if there are no constraints to rerouting the piping, you can do it. Otherwise, there are limitations with this in brownfield projects also. So let's say you're not able to reroute it. Then what you do is you use this vent valve method, which is when you shut it down, the gas is getting recycled back to the suction like this. What you do is a portion of this gas, you also vent it. You can also do that. This is one way. So if the discharge volume is too large, and by the time this valve opens and you're not able to recycle enough flow into the suction, you have to find a way to take all this gas back to the suction to maintain forward flow. But let's say the anti-surge valve is not able to do it, the controller is too sluggish, and the piping volumes are also, the discharge side volume is also too high. Then what you do is you take some of the gas and throw it out. You evacuate the gas. Now, this method makes sense for non-toxic gases like air compressors. You can vent the gas to the atmosphere. There's no problem. Is it possible for toxic gases like hydrocarbons, like natural gas? Yes, it is possible. The only thing is that you connect it to a flare. But what that means is you're going to have emission issues. So do have a look at your rules and local rules and regulations on emission standards before you think of using this vent valve method. So in the case of vent valve, the anti-surge ASV will open, and so does the vent valve open, and some of it is recycling. So some of it is recycling, and quickly you're able to also evacuate. That way the gas is not being given a chance to flow back into the gas compressor. Now, let's say for some reason, for you're in some place on the planet where you've got some ESG fellows, environmental groups, saying nothing doing. The government is also saying nothing doing. We are going to bring in more tougher regulations. Therefore, you cannot vent, if they say. Then what you do is, after all these methods have failed, no matter what you did, nothing worked. Then what you do is you put a hot gas bypass. That is, you're just putting another recycle line, like the cold recycle line, which is after the cooler, but you put a hot recycle line. You're short circuiting the loop. The reason why we say it is hot gases, it is because it is before the cooler. The gas is still hot, let's say 120 degrees Celsius here and 40 degrees Celsius here. And by putting the hot gas bypass, instead of waiting for all this gas, it takes some time for it to come here. What you do is you take a shortcut and recycle some of the gas here. Now, if you read these P&IDs, they say the hot gas line should be recycled for 50% of the flow. But now you have dynamic simulation. That is where you have the advantage. You don't necessarily have to recycle 50% of the flow. You even with 20% or 25% or even 30%, you can keep the operating point away from the surge line. But for that, you have to do a dynamic simulation. So in this line of work, as an engineer, when you do dynamic simulation, your main work is to do whatever it takes to prevent the gas compressor from going into surge and also maintain production. Surge can happen during startup, normal shutdown, or emergency shutdown, and also during a process disturbance. So therefore, you have to do a surge analysis for startups, shutdown, and normal shutdown and emergency shutdown. Number two, in case you have, let's say, parallel compressors, you are doing a dynamic simulation to also see if the control system is good enough to prevent a surge from happening and also maintain production. So let's say you have three compressors in parallel. And let's say one of the compressor failed. So three compressors are running at 3000 RPM, delivering 3000 meter cube per hour. Let's say if one of the compressor tripped, you're doing a dynamic simulation to check if I increase this compressor speed from 3000 to 3500 RPM or whatever it is, both the compressors, can I still maintain 3000 RPM? So you have three lines, 3000 each. If one compressor fails, you can only deliver 2000 meter cube per hour. If I want to continue to maintain 3000 meter cube per hour, then what you do is you increase the speed of the first two compressors. Instead of 3000, you have to estimate how much do I have to raise the speed to continue to maintain an export. Okay, in this case, let's say the export flow rate was 3000 meter cube per hour. To maintain that, how much should the speed be increased? So these are the main purpose. These are some of the examples of why you are doing dynamic simulation for a gas compressors. You will do these things during the FEED stage. Sometimes at the proposal stage also, you can do it to check if you need a hot gas bypass or not, or what should be the size of a driver.